Well, hey there, and welcome to another one of my cheesy YouTube videos. On this video, we're going to take apart the carburetor on this Troy Bilt Horse rototiller that's sitting behind me. It has a Briggs Stratton 8 horsepower IC engine. It's one of those little flathead engines, and it's got a flow jet carburetor. So let's get started. Okay, this is known as a flow jet carburetor. In order to take it apart, you got to take the top cover off. In this case, there's three bolt holes. But before you do that, you got to take this needle valve out and go up inside there and remove the main nozzle. The reason being is that nozzle protrudes up in the carburetor like such, all the way through the air passage and into the upper housing on the opposite side. So when you try to lift it apart, the nozzle restricts you from doing that. So keep in mind though, in my case, I had a kit and the nozzle would not come out. Took the needle valve out. I reached up in there with a screwdriver and tried to unscrew the nozzle. On the nozzle, you gotta be real careful about the groove the screwdriver goes into. It's best to use a tool similar to this that's got good straight sides to it, so it will try not to jump out of the nozzle when you unscrew it. Typical screwdrivers that will fit up in there, this one right here be the one I was using, they have a habit of slipping out, up and out. And in the process, they destroy the brass and they round it out to where nothing will go up in there and do the job anymore. And even using this, I could not get the sucker out of there. So I went ahead and I worked the top off and I forced it apart. It wasn't bad, wasn't hard to do. The nozzle actually seemed like it was still in place, but I really wanted that nozzle out. I did contemplate, can I just clean it with the nozzle in and not bother with it? But it's a YouTube video, I might as well go that extra step. So what I wound up doing, this is the old nozzle and I've drilled it out since then, but there's a real small hole for the fuel to go up through the nozzle. And I had a tiny twist style easy out. And I tapped up in there and I knew it was a dumb idea even before I tapped it in there. So I tapped it in there and I actually heated it with a little butane torch. Didn't get too hot. You don't want to get this pot metal real hot or it could come apart on you. And I tried backing off and the easy out broke. So there I am with a little teeny easy out broken up inside that nozzle. Now I knew I had to get it apart. So that's when I went ahead and said, I'll just break this end off. And then I took a drill bit that would, a little bit smaller than the hole inside there from this end. And I drilled from this direction. It broke off right here. So I drilled it this way. This end is a lot thicker. So if I was to stab a drill bit in here and get the wrong size, I could very well drill into the aluminum housing when I got up into here. So I drilled from this way with a drill bit that I knew was small enough. I drilled it and it kept going through the brass, it went real easy. Then I could tell when I hit the easy out. And then I spent a considerable amount of time taking this punch, trying to drive that easy out. When you get in a situation like this, don't rush. And actually at one point, I went ahead and just gave up on it for the day and tackled it the next day with a better frame of mind. And lo and behold, at some point, that easy out popped out. And then I actually drilled from this direction with even yet a bigger diameter. And that allowed me to move up to a different and bigger easy out. I used this square one. And I was able to drive it up in there, into the nozzle. And then I used a heat gun and it backed out and it worked. So patience paid off. If you are concerned about the threads at all inside here, these threads are a 5/16 32 tap. 32 is odd. Typically, it's 5/16 18 or 5/16 24. But in this case, it's 5/16 diameter, 32 threads per inch. And that tap is available. I found them on Amazon. Just while I'm at it, this nozzle has a taper right here. There's a mating taper inside this carburetor housing. This taper is supposed to seal up inside that housing right about in here. And if you have a problem with that taper, what happens is your fuel level's right about here. It will sneak past this taper and it will leak into the carburetor and your carburetor will just sit there and drip when it's not running. So what I'm going to do is somewhere around here, I've got some permanent marker. I'm going to mark this with the permanent marker. I'm going to screw it up in there and see if I don't put a mark on here showing me that the taper is mating. So let me get set up. Okay, you're seeing this for the first time like I am. I hope the heck I don't get disappointed. I've got permanent marker on that taper. Dropping it in there. Yeah, I don't know if you can see it, but it's white clean all the way around. So the chances are it's going to be a good seat. This doesn't go in until the very end. So let me set it aside. Okay, let's talk about how this carburetor functions. This is the float. First thing you do when you take a float off is you shake it. You listen for sloshing. If there is, that means there's a hole in the float. You either need to replace it or fix it. The needle valve hangs on the float like so. This is the hole the needle valve goes into, and there's a mating seat inside that hole that the needle valve sits into. And I looked around in my kit. I do not see a replacement brass seat. So I was going to press it out and replace it, but I don't see one in this kit. There we go. Pins in. The valve sits in like so. And the brass tab on the float pushes against the needle valve. And it's actually upside down. If you set it in like this, that's all the way up. It should be shut off. So I should be able to blow in this hole right here, and this should not blow through. It will not blow through, but as it drops, it should start blowing through. So the correct adjustment on the float is that the float should sit parallel to this top of the carburetor. Shouldn't be like this, and it shouldn't be the opposite direction. And if you got to adjust the float, which I think this one's going to be good enough, but if you got to adjust the float, take yourself needle nose and just reach up in there and bend on this tab. Don't force the float. Don't push on the float to adjust it. So needle valve sits in there, fuel level drops down, needle valve drops off his seat, fuel starts to pour in, fill the bowl up, float floats back up, shuts the needle valve off. And that float just sits here and keeps the fuel level constant in the bowl. And see that needle valve stuck. I'll have to play with that. I'll have to flush it out with carb cleaner. Take something up in there and clean it up real good, because the gravity pressure of the fuel is probably not enough to push that needle valve off the seat. This is the throttle. If you look up in this direction, you'll see there's a little slot up in there, and that is where fuel comes up through a passage right here and out that slot. And that happens when the throttle plate is in its closed position, which is never all the way closed. There'll be a little bit of a cut gap there. And now when the engine's cranking and that engine's creating a suction, it will suck fuel out of that little slot and that is your idle circuit. Then as your throttle plate starts open and allow fuel, more fuel to go into the system. This carburetor is a little different than typical cars and stuff, and how this nozzle works. With this nozzle up through here, the nozzle itself travels through the main air passage. And in this nozzle is some pin holes. And with this nozzle screwed in place, fuel will be up in that main nozzle close to that area. And this end of the main nozzle is embedded in a cutout in the top section. Sits in there like so. Fuel is picked up from them little pinholes and sucked into the airstream going into the engine. Fuel comes out the end of this main nozzle in that little cutout I just showed you inside here when it's idling. So this main nozzle is not only for the run circuit, but it's also for the idle circuit. Carbureted machinery have to have the bowl vented to atmosphere. So that way when fuel is draining out, being used, and going back in, fluctuating back and forth, you don't want a vacuum created inside there messing around with the float and the fuel level. So it needs to be, flow needs to flow freely into that bowl. And that's why vent is very important. Right through here, this is drilled out. Right in through here, across here, and it drops out this little hole right here. That is your bowl vent. The inlet for the bowl vent is right inside the carburetor here. We've got another little feature going on in here. And there's another little vent, an air port right here, that goes down, and it actually allows air to enter the same place this main jet screws into there. And I do believe that is to allow for to allow air to mix in with the fuel as it goes through the nozzle. But this vent could also have something to do with allowing fuel to travel through that nozzle and prevent a vacuum or anything in there. But anyways, so that vent's important too. And you just I've been taking a welding tip cleaner and I've shoved it through every hole in this carburetor. Okay, other considerations on with your throttle closed, it creates a vacuum to suck the fuel up, like I just said. If this throttle shaft, if it was slap wore out, which I've seen before, then now you got a big old air gap in there, and that will very well allow air to pass between the shaft and the housing. It will rob the carburetor of being able to function properly. So too much play in this shaft is a no-no. Flow jet carburetors have an inherited problem, and that is the housing being warped. And I actually thought that was my problem, but then I looked at it, had a teeny, teeny, teeny bit of gasket on here, and the opposite sides of these same screws. So what it was allowing this, the top plate, to rock on that old gasket. Scraped it off, cleaned it up real good. It's, for the most part, it's real good. It's got a teeny bit of rock, but the gasket's going to take care of that. So that is the problem you need to look for, because what happens there is, or if your float sticks, it'll come out and it'll pour out this gasket. And actually, this carburetor actually was doing that. On your fuel intake, where the fuel comes in to the carburetor, you'll have a fitting similar to this. You might want to take this fitting off and check it, because a lot of these fittings will have a little screen inside here. So that screen will be up in here, and you'll never know it's in there with that fitting screwed in. And this one may have actually had a screen, because the way it's got a little step inside there, but it doesn't have the screen now. So I pulled this one out just to make sure there wasn't a screen. So I would definitely take that apart and check that. As far as the needle getting stuck in its seat, I can push it in there, turn it upside down. See if falls right out now. I rolled some emery cloth up, stuck it in there, and just twisted it. Then I actually took the nozzle, put it in there, put a little bit of outside pressure on it. I twisted it and just cleaned the outside walls of that where the seat is. So now it just drops in there and it doesn't want to stay in there. I need to take the little wire off of the old needle valve. Put it on the new one. Hang it from the little tab. Got to put the carburetor gasket on. This gasket's got a front and a back because this hole for the bowl vent is off center. It only lined up with the bowl vent one way. Now I can put the float and the needle valve back in place. Put the pin in. The needle valve drops with the float. Float looks square with the body. So next step is to put the two halves together. There she goes. Okay, I can feel the, I can hear the float clunking around, which is good. I'm not hunkering down on any particular one yet because I know this bowl has a reputation of wanting to warp. I believe the gasket's making a seal. Maybe a little tighter on these. Put the new needle valve. This is for the idle circuit. Run it in, don't force it. When you feel it bottom out, back it out. A turn or a turn and a half. One, I'm gonna go one and a half, one and a half. Next is the nozzle. I guess technically this is a nozzle with a jet built into it. And there's a taper in there for your needle valve to go into. A lot of times you can take a screwdriver and you can grind it down, make a nice square bit on it. And I do believe you can order screwdrivers just for this application. Okay, that's tight. You got your main needle valve. And in this case, I'm replacing it. This thing's all crusty and nasty, looking very bad shape. But on the end, you got a, should be a brass washer like this. And then a O-ring, which is a little black O-ring somewhere. That has been flattened out, that goes on here, and that goes up in here, and that O-ring seals this pin to the inside of this housing, and there's also a fiber gasket on the bottom here. Only screw your needle valve into this piece right here about a turn, because you don't want to force the needle valve into its seat. I need a valve still goes in, so that's good. Run it in. It bottomed out. I'm going to back it off, turn it a half. One half, one, one and a half. There you have it. We're done, went through this little carburetor. I will put it on the tiller here in a little bit, and we'll see if she runs. Thank you for watching my video. Please hit the like button and subscribe to my channel. And remember, if you love life and learning new things, go aimless.com. leaking. It idles good and it revs up good. Throttle linkage on these old tillers don't always work. I think on this one all I've been doing is running up the idle screw to the RPMs I want to tilt with. Let me get to work.